believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That life I have, everlasting, eternal, that's evangelical. Through the evangel, through the gospel, because Jesus purchased it for me. And because Jesus provided it for me, and by faith, I stretch out my hand of faith and I receive that righteousness. It is not self-righteousness. It is not external righteousness. It is not religious righteousness. It is not righteousness of do's and don'ts. It is the righteousness coming from Christ. In fact, it says that we become the righteousness of God through him. That means there's a good transaction. There's an exchange. I give him all my sins, and he gives me his righteousness. That exchange is the evangelical righteousness we are talking about. And then there is what we call an enduring righteousness. There are some people that, you know, they come to a meeting, for example, and then they hear the gospel. I will say that you want to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Where are you? Raise up your hand. And they raise up their hands, and that is great. We don't want to come up forward here. They come forward, and then they pray the sinner's prayer, and they say, praise the Lord, I am saved because I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then they go away. We never find them again. We say, when the righteousness comes in, there is what you call enduring righteousness. He that believes on me. Not that I believed in the past. Am I believing today? Do I continue to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ? And that's what I'm going to examine with you. I'm going to look at number one, external righteousness. And that's what the Pharisees, the certificate, all demonstrated about. And, you know, Jesus was talking about something great and something he brought from heaven. They say, we don't need that. We already got this. We've been in church since we were born. We've been baptized in water. We pay our tithes. We've done this. We've done that. And they could refer to some outward external things they have done, which they were still doing. And the Lord said, except your righteousness goes beyond that external righteousness, you will in no wise see the kingdom of God. There is something beyond what we could do by ourselves, something we could produce by human energy, something we could do by trying. I'm trying my best. I want to turn over a new leaf. You'll find when you turn over that new leaf is still as dirty as ever because it's still coming from the fig tree of Adam and Eve. You know how they sewed that together and they felt, we'll protect ourselves. Adam, where are you? I heard your voice in the garden and I hid myself. Why did you hide yourself? Because of this. Have you eaten of that fruit? Instead of yes or no, well, really, you understand, this is not my fault. I was just staying like this. And then you said, I needed a wife. And then you gave me a wife. I want to announce to you, God, that woman you gave me, he made me do this. As for me, I'm all right. As for you, know, I wouldn't have done that. Why it not for that woman? And we're still in that excuse making today. And we're still telling the Lord, I'm all right, but she is not all right. I'm all right, but he is not right. All right. And why it not for the connection you made between us? I would have been as perfect as ever. And that's what the Pharisees did. Every other person was wrong, but they were right. And the Lord was saying, all that excuse making and all that external righteousness, we pack that aside and we say, we come. Nothing in my hand I bring. Simply to the cross I cling. The rock of ages cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. And it is when we come for that which Christ has provided that we have that evangelical righteousness. And there is a word, I don't know whether you are familiar with this word. It's not the word you think. When I say guilt, you'll be thinking of G-U-I-L-T. That's the condemnation or the guilt that we have. But there's a word that is guilt. The same pronunciation, but it's G-I-L-T. And it's a kind of thin, kind of thing you put on something, like gold, for example, layer that you put on something. Inside is another metal, but all you see is the gold. And that's what I talk about, number one, the guilt of external righteousness. And the Pharisees had that a lot. A beautiful exterior, a wonderful exterior, and it appeared you couldn't fault it. If you were to examine a Pharisee and you were to say, Do you do this? Mark that. Yes, I do. Hi about this. Yes, I do. Hi about that. Yes, I do. This man appears all right. When you find a man that has all his righteousness well composed and put in place, but without Christ, without the cross, and without the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, and everything appears all right, but without the sacrifice and the salvation that Jesus Christ brought, we say that's just a guilt of external righteousness, a thin layer of what appears to be good, what appears to be all right, without depending upon the sacrifice and the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's see what Jesus said about those Pharisees. What I'm talking about now is the guilt, the thin layer of external righteousness. In Matthew chapter 23, here Jesus was talking to them, and these were the people that thought, we've got it all made, and we can get to heaven by ourselves, and we can walk to heaven, we can live our lives so perfectly that God will not be able to find any fault in this. He said, do this, I did. They were not looking at the motive of what they did, at the intention of what they did. They were not looking at their thoughts, at their lives, and at the love of God that should be in their hearts. Because the greatest commandment is you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And if you were to call any average person, or even any kind of morally good person, have you loved the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength? The answer will be no. And yet they didn't understand that. They thought, we've got it all made. That's what Jesus Christ said. All you have is a thin layer over the corruption that is within. Matthew chapter 23, I'm reading from verse 28 there. It says in verse 28, it says, in the same way, on the outside, you appear to people as righteous. On the outside, there's this thin layer that covered everything. There's this religious kind of practice that covered everything. And I can say, I don't do this, I don't do this. By the time you are talking to some people who say they are Christians, you say, are you a Christian? Of course I am. Who do you think I am? A pagan? How do you know that you're a Christian? I don't smoke, one. I don't drink, two. I don't do this, I don't do that. I hear what you don't do, tell me what you do. They don't understand that it's not just what you don't do, how about what you do? And it's not about just what you do, what do you believe and who do you believe? Because it's a matter of believing him. Remember once again, he says, God so loved the world, and he loved you as part of that world. If you were the only sinner, the only lost person in the world, Christ would still have died for you. And you're not thinking about, you know, everybody else. You know, sometimes when we think about the world, we're thinking about that person and that person. Wait a minute. When you are hungry, although I might be hungry, but you just think of your own hunger. And when you have a problem, a pain in your, maybe your foot or somewhere, you're not thinking about all the other people in the hospitals. You are thinking about the pain you have. So when we say, when the word of God says, God so loved the world, you say, that's me, not just the whole world. That if I were the only sinful person in the whole universe, the Lord Jesus Christ would still have died on the cross of Calvary. But what have I done about that death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary? Then it says that whosoever, and that's me, whosoever, say that's me. That's you. That whosoever believes, whosoever does, whosoever does not know, whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. We can call all the Pharisees at the time of Jesus Christ one by one and say, do you do or you believe? Their religion was a religion of do, not a religion of believing. I do this, I do this. It's not what you've done, what you've not done. It's what he has done. Instead of the two letters do, I do, I do, I do, or I don't, I don't, I don't, he's saying it is what has been done on the cross of Calvary. And because I believe that, and I believe that it was for me he died, and he rose again for my justification, that's the reason I can say I have the righteousness that is acceptable unto the Lord. But this external thing, see, Jesus said in verse 28, he said, in the same way, on the outside, you appear, not that you are, but you appear to people, not to God, not to Christ, not to your conscience even, but unto people outside of you. You appear as righteous, but on the inside, you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. And that's the reason why the external righteousness alone will not cut it, will not be sufficient, and will not be acceptable in the sight of the Lord. If you look at Luke chapter 18, I'm reading this so you don't take my word for it. You don't say he said. You'll be able to say the word of God said that the guilt or the thin layer of so-called righteousness, external righteousness, will not do. It's going to take something deeper. It's going to take something richer. It's going to take something that is coming from Calvary to be able to get us in relationship and fellowship with God in heaven. It says in Luke chapter 18, verse 9, in verse 9 it says, to some who were confident of their own righteousness, not God's righteousness, of their own righteousness. That was their confidence. And you'll see what the man said as we read on, that the righteousness was, this is what I do and this is what I don't do. And the comparison of his life was not with Christ. It was with, you know, somebody else. And it's like when your child has gone to school, and your child comes back from school, and he has some paper in his hand, and the teacher has checked all his papers and everything, and they say, my boy, what do I see that on the paper? Oh, he said, mommy, before you look at, the mark I got, do you know that there were three other students in my class that were behind me? If you got 19%, you might have somebody else that got 17% or 15% or 14%. The people that are less than you, they do not justify you. That there are people that are better than so-and-so, and better than so-and-so. You can always find somebody that you are better than. You're better than a thief. You're better than a highway robber. You only steal privately, and therefore you are better than the other fellow that carries a knife or carries a gun. That you are better than other people is no excuse, and that does not justify you in the sight of the Lord. All that this Pharisee could say was that, God, you know me. I'm not the worst man on the street. I'm better than this other person. And that qualification, that I'm better than the other person, it doesn't really justify me. Am I as good as God wants me to? No, I am not. Can I be? No, I cannot be. But the Lord can take the righteousness of Christ that he's pleased with. He can put that into my account. And I can say by the grace of God, because he makes me righteous. As he who covers me with his righteousness, then I know that my righteousness is acceptable in the sight of the Lord. Not because I'm better than him, I'm better than her, I'm better than the other fellow. It's not a matter of comparison, it's a matter of conversion. Coming to the Lord and saying, Lord, this is what you have done. And I pray that that faith in Christ will be in every one of us, that will make him to impute and impart his righteousness unto us in Jesus' name. Look at this in verse 9. It says, to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else. Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray. The one, a Pharisee, and the other, a tax collector. And the Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. He wasn't praying to God, really. He was just about to say, oh, Lord, did you see that thing I did? Did you see how good I am? You didn't even comment that, this, I heard you commenting about Jesus Christ. That's my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. How about me? I'm here to you. Okay, if you will not talk about me, can I talk about myself to you? Can I give you information that you've not heard about me, you've not recognized about me? Can you think of a church man, a church woman, a religious fellow giving information to God? Oh God, if you have not taken note of who I am, can I introduce myself to you? Can I give you some information you never knew, you never thought of, that this is who I am? And if you do that here on earth, you can still have a chance to be forgiven. What if you become deluded and deceived until you get to the brink or you get to the grave? And then you get to eternity, and then you just say, oh Lord, this is who I am. And the Lord says, anything more? You say, no, that's all I am. And the Lord says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All the Pharisees, all these good people, all these nice people, all these people that had this veneer or this thin layer of righteousness and that covers a lot of corruption within, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But the only righteousness that will be acceptable on that final day, that I am seen and you are seen in his righteousness, that he does that perfectly, and then he gave that to you, the gift of righteousness. And let's see what he's saying here. He says in verse 11, the Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself, God, I thank you that I am not like other men. You can tell immediately that this is not the way to approach God. When you come, I am not like other men. But think about it. If everybody were like you in the whole world, in the whole universe, will the world be a better place? Think about that. We're talking about this one is bad, that one is bad, that one is evil, that one is evil. We are the only angel in the whole park. But if everybody were like, just like you, the angel you are talking about, will the world be a better place? But of course, no, because we'll have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It is only this righteousness of Christ coming into our lives that is going to make the change. And if that change is not there yet, it can come there today. It will come there in Jesus' name. And here it says, I thank you. I'm not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice in a week and give tithes of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus said, I tell you that this man, the publican, rather than the other, the Pharisee, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he that humbles himself will be exalted. That means to start with, that all the external righteousness, all the things we have been saying about, I don't do this, I do this, I don't do that, I do this, all that we push aside and we say, Lord, nothing in my hands I bring. Simply to the cross I cling. Rock of ages that Jesus has cleft for me, broken for me, let me hide myself in you. God, my tears forever flow and my zeal no respite know. All this cannot atone for sin. Thou and thou alone must save. It's not Jesus Christ and my good works, Jesus Christ and my offering, Jesus Christ and whatever, my religion. Only thou and thou alone can save. That brings me to the second point, the gift of evangelical righteousness. The gift. We've seen the guilt, that's a covering, the thing that covers our corruption internally, but which is not acceptable in the sight of the Lord. Now we talk about the gift of evangelical righteousness. By the use of that word gift, you know, we don't earn it. There's some people that, you know, they want to work out their salvation.